It's one of the most profound mysteries in the natural world. An amazing transcontinental odyssey. The migration each year of millions of monarch butterflies from Canada, across America, to Mexico.
We've got a butterfly that's originating in Toronto, or it's originating in Detroit, Michigan. It's coming down from St. Paul, maybe even Winnipeg, and it's moving south. And somehow it finds its way to Mexico. Could you do that?
Starting from a tiny caterpillar, blossoming into a beautiful butterfly, these delicate creatures will fly thousands of miles in a feat of endurance and navigation unlike anything else in nature.
They've never taken a long flight in their lives, and they're on the way to an area that they've never seen before. Somehow they're recognizing landmarks, or following streams, or following the sun. They're following something.
They're on their way to a remote area high in the Mexican mountains. And they get there every year at exactly the same time.
Butterflies have dazzled humans for millennia. It's a beautiful little creature, and on top of that, it migrates 2,000 miles. And this just staggers the mind.
I think the monarch butterfly is one of the most magnificent animals in the world. And it's unique in terms of the entire animal kingdom. There's nothing like it.
Next on NOVA, the incredible journey of the butterflies.
ExxonMobil, taking on the world's toughest energy challenges. And by David H. Koch. And
discovering new knowledge. HHMI.
And by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
On a late August morning, just north of Lake Huron in Canada, a miracle of nature is about to unfold. This tiny caterpillar is destined to become a monarch butterfly. One of the most amazing transformations in the animal world, the caterpillar will outgrow and shed its skin four times. caterpillar disappears. It's transformed into a chrysalis, a delicate case within which a completely new being takes form. After about 10 days in the chrysalis, the new creature is complete. All traces of the caterpillar are gone. And in its place is a butterfly with four delicate wings. The newly developed monarch butterfly must wait a few hours for its wings to harden. And then, finally, it can fly. This particular generation of monarch butterflies is special. Every year, about 100 million of them begin an astonishing migration. Coming from southern Canada and the northeastern United States, each butterfly, starting on its own, flies about 2,000 miles. Arriving 2 months later in Mexico. Their trip is part of a carefully timed cycle that began three generations back, when a group of monarchs left Mexico at the end of the winter. They flew as far north as the Gulf States, mated, and died. The second generation flew to the northern United States. There, they too mated and died, living only about a month. Their offspring, the third generation, completed the last leg of the journey to Canada, also surviving only about a month. But the fourth generation will live almost 9 months, and they'll fly all the way back to Mexico in one epic trip. It's an amazing natural cycle that so far eludes explanation. The mystery starts at the very beginning of the trip, because no one knows exactly what triggers the exodus from Canada.
But when the monarchs leave Canada, they have a 2,000-mile trek ahead of them, at least. They're freshly hatched butterflies. They've never taken a long flight in their lives, and they're on the way to an area that they've never seen before. Somehow they're recognizing landmarks or following streams or following the sun or following something. We just don't know exactly how they do it. It's really an incredible journey.
A monarch's wingspan is just under 4 inches, and they weigh less than 1/5 of an ounce. So how they survived their marathon migration is another mystery. They only fly when conditions are perfect. If it's too cold, they get sluggish and can't flap their wings. If it's too hot, they stop flying so they don't get overheated. They must also stop often for nectar and water. But every time they land, there can be enemies lurking. Bad weather is also the monarch's enemy. A rainstorm can be deadly. If it survives enemy attacks and bad weather, a monarch that started in Canada has to fly at least 50 miles a day to get to Mexico. The physical effort this requires is remarkable for a creature so small, with such fragile wings.
Butterflies are the worst possible body form for trying to make a long distance migration. They're simply a bad design. Every time they flap their wings, they're using energy at least 20 times the rate than when they're not flapping it. So they're just burning their fuel up at a great rate, much like, say, a helicopter might. And so they have to compensate for their inadequacies by soaring. Soaring is gliding in rising air, much like I'm doing right now. The sun heats the ground heats the air above it. As the air heats, it expands and becomes lighter and begins to rise. And pretty soon you have a column of rising air. That's the thermal. Under good conditions, you can maintain the altitude you're at or even gain altitude. A more helpful maneuver is to circle in it. And you see hawks doing this and vultures doing this all the time. Circling in the thermal, staying within it, and this seems like a wonderful free ride, and it is. Soaring's the key to them getting to Mexico.
On the shores of the Great Lakes, just days into their journey, the monarchs face their first geographic hurdle. Miles of open water and constantly shifting winds.
As the monarchs are migrating out of Canada, they hit the Great Lakes, which are a barrier. They can't see across them.
With no land in sight, monarchs use their finely tuned sense of the direction of the wind to carry them across the water. If wind from the south, a headwind, threatens to blow them off course, they stop and wait. When they sense that the wind has shifted in their favor, they fly on. The ultimate destination of their incredible journey is a tiny area about 60 square miles and 10,000 feet high in the mountains of Mexico. The local people, called the Mazahua, have lived here for hundreds of years. They believe monarchs represent the spirits of their ancestors, and the arrival of the butterflies each year begins a celebration called the Day of the Dead.
It's a very beautiful time when the butterflies arrive. The butterflies would come down, surround us, coming down to give the final touch to the tradition of the Day of the Dead.
De la tradición del Día de Muertos.
For those who live here, it's our belief from when I was a child. We would say they were the souls of our departed loved ones. Every year I make an altar. We put these things here because when our ancestors were alive, this is what they liked. That's why one waits for their arrival, to give them this offering.
The legends of the people that live near the ocean and the mountains are important to them. For us, there is a sense of space. The freedom to fly with imagination, to fly just like a butterfly.
Homero Arregis is one of Mexico's best-loved writers. He grew up in these hills and has fought to preserve them for monarchs. Every year, Lincoln Brower comes here to continue his study of the monarch migration.
When you were a young boy, Homero, yes. Did you used to go up to see the butterflies?
Yes, every year we came with the school children, and for us it was one of the most fantastic spectacles of the year, to go to the plain of the mule to see the butterflies. But the butterflies also came to the town. They were across the streets.
They flew through the town.
Exactly. They were looking for water. Sometimes there was in your house. But there were millions of butterflies. And for us, it was a spontaneous miracle to see butterflies here in the Cerro Altamirano. But we didn't know that they were coming from Canada, across the United States. And the Canadians and Americans didn't know that they were coming to these places.
It was not until 1975 that scientists discovered the full extent of the North American migration, when butterflies that had been tagged in Canada were found spending the winter here. These monarchs return each year to 12 specific sites in these mountains. This is their only destination in the world. It's a perfect environment for the butterflies because of the unique climate.
We're talking constantly about this microclimatic envelope, about 3,100 meters, usually on southwest-facing slopes. If you imagine the forest as a blanket that protects the butterflies by keeping the heat in, and also think of it as an umbrella that keeps the rain out. And the tree is like a hot water bottle. It's radiating heat out through the bodies of the butterflies. So when the temperature drops down really low, you'll see millions of monarchs just festooning these beautiful trunk clusters. If you think about it, the bigger the tree, the more heat it holds. So this is an argument for maintaining the forest in its native state, to let the trees get as big as they can, and the butterflies will be protected during those cold periods.
Monarchs live in other parts of the world in warm climates, but only Canadian and North American monarchs migrate such an incredible distance to avoid the certain death of a cold winter. And exactly how they navigate from Canada to Mexico is another unsolved mystery. scientists only have a few clues. One theory is that the butterflies navigate by following a specific angle of the sun in relation to the Earth. Another theory proposes that the Earth's magnetic field may provide a subtle orientation guide. And recently, biologists discovered specific cells in the butterfly's brain that regulate their internal clock and help keep them on course. At the University of Kansas, Chip Taylor studies the forces at work in the monarch migration.
You've got a butterfly that's originating in Toronto, or it's originating in Point Pelee, or it's originating in Detroit, Michigan. It's coming down from St. Paul, it's maybe even Winnipeg, and it's moving south. And somehow it finds its way to Mexico. Could you do that?
And so now you need to tell whether or not it's a male or a female. And so this picture
shows. In 1992, Taylor started a project called Monarch Watch.
Are there any over here? Nope, so you know that one's a girl. So let's check out your butterfly.
School children and teachers tag butterflies from all over the northeastern United States. The tags don't hurt the butterflies and don't affect their ability to fly. But when tagged butterflies are recovered at various stops along the way to Mexico, tracing back the information on the tags helps reveal their flight path and their traveling speed.
Let her go.
And one of Taylor's tagging experiments had a surprising outcome.
We ran some experiments a few years ago. So we took butterflies and we transferred them to Washington, D.C. And initially, when we released them in Washington, D.C., they behaved as if they were still in Kansas.
The butterflies who'd been moved to Washington started out flying in the same direction they would have taken to Mexico from their original home in Kansas, almost directly south. But starting from Washington, that flight path would never get them to Mexico. Amazingly, after a few days, the displaced monarchs somehow reoriented themselves and changed course to a strong southwest heading. That meant that even starting from an unfamiliar location, they still ended up in the right place in Mexico.
Now, this is really exciting stuff, because what this says is that
Sup, 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 sup
Sup, 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 sup Sup, 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 sup I'm Alicia Woodruff, and welcome to the Fort Report. Smell that? That is the smell of spring in the air. No, not the compost pile. Grossology was last week. This week, we're here at the Botanic Garden, where not only is spring in the air, but so are the butterflies. So I'm here with Steve Huddleston, the senior horticulturist here at the Botanic Gardens. And Steve, I would love it if you'd tell us a little bit about butterflies in the garden.
Well, it's an event that we have every other year, and we feature as many as 12,000 butterflies. We will release that many over a five-week period during the course of this exhibit.
What can people learn from this kind of exhibit?
Well, they can learn all about the butterflies themselves, where they come from, their colors, their patterns, and so forth. As people come into the conservatory, they can, of course, see the butterflies. We have a brochure that identifies many of those butterflies, and also they can see the butterflies emerge from the chrysalis in our pupae palace. So that's an exciting part of the event.
When would you say is the best time to come and beat the crowds?
Really, the best time would be early in the week, so Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday. Yes, it'll be less crowded.
So I'm here with Dale Clark, and he is one of the lepidopterists here at the Botanic Gardens. And Dale, I have to ask you, about how many butterflies are here and where do they all come from?
Currently, we probably have released about 3,000 into the conservatory.
Wow.
They come from butterfly farms from all over the world. Philippines, Malaysia, Africa, Central South America, and we'll have a few from my own butterfly farm in southern Dallas County.
Oh, cool! So. That's awesome! Do you have a favorite part of the exhibit?
I like letting the butterflies go. We receive them in the pupa stage, and part of my job is pinning those pupas up and waiting for the butterflies to emerge, and then we transfer them into the conservatory in these little collapsible cages and release them. And so it's kind of nice to see them take flight and fly about the conservatory and listen to people ooh and ah about them.
The exhibit is open daily through April 8th, and tours run from 10 a.m. through 4 p.m. So if you'd like more information on ticket prices, tours, and more, just visit the Botanic Gardens website. And you know, there's more than just butterflies to see at the Botanic Gardens. Tours of the various gardens are available for groups, and there are plenty of special events. Celebrate spring and get a taste of Japanese culture at the Spring Festival in the Japanese Garden, April 28th through the 29th. If being in the garden makes you want to do a little gardening of your own, stop by the Spring Plant Sale, 9 a.m. to 2 p.m., April 21st. And of course, you can find information on these events and many more on the Botanic Gardens website.